I've known Chanan for a while, and have always been charmed by him and excited to read something of his. And this is really my introduction to his work, and was so blown away, Chanan, by this book. It's pleasures. There's so many different pleasures that you get from reading the book, and it's the adventure of it, the scholarship of it, and the fun of it, and the excellent writing. And you do have someone who can write a historical tale, but who has writing chops, who can really tell a vivid story. But I wanted to sort of, I guess start with your father, who and his interest in how he brought you into this. There's a description of you guys around the dinner table, which I loved early on.
It all goes back to my father.
Yes.
My mother always says, you always blame the mother. But in this book, we blame the father.
A rabbi and Bible scholar whose most important work to date is a 600-page commentary on the Deuteronomy, the very book that got Shapira into so much trouble. My father spent 16 years honing his analysis, and so, like Shapira, understands a good Deuteronomy obsession. Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, for sure. And first, before I talk about the Deuteronomy obsession, I want to thank Stephanie Singer and the JCC for hosting us, Green Apple Books, and especially Tom for agreeing to do this when he has his own book due.
It's true.
And so I really appreciate it.
Tom is the same publisher, actually.
So Tom is a Bay Area gem who writes short stories and novels and nonfiction, and you just have to read the reviews to know that he's well worth reading. So thank you so much, Tom,
My
for
pleasure.
Coming. And I should also say, thank you all for coming. Today is not only 420, which is a big deal in this town, but there's also a Freedom Seder out there. So we are actually competing with marijuana and freedom this evening. So that you came here is, I really appreciate it. So, yeah, I mean, I first learned the story that became this book sitting around the dinner table with my father and the rest of my family. So I had recently written a few articles about biblical hoaxes. They'd found, you know, that year they discovered Noah's Ark again, which they tend to do about once annually. And it took about 5,000 years to discover it and about 5 days for them to debunk it as a total fraud. Some Chinese evangelicals had dragged a bunch of wooden beams up to the top of Mount Ararat in Turkey, left them there for a couple years to freeze over, and then they came back up a few years later and said, holy cow, there's Noah's Ark. Turns out it was a fraud. So I was telling this story, and I'd just written an article about it at the dinner table, and my father said, you want to hear a real biblical hoax story. And he started telling this story about a man named Moses Wilhelm Shapira, who was a Jew who came from the Pale of Settlement and converted to Christianity, ended up as an antiquities dealer in Jerusalem, and got himself in quite a lot of trouble over the book of Deuteronomy. I mean, maybe what I should do is just sort of talk a little bit about what happened from there. I think, the story begins in the sort of main thrust of the story begins in the summer of 1883, when this guy Shapira shows up in London at the doorstep of the British Museum, and he says, I've got the oldest copy of the Bible in the world here in my carpet bag, and I want to sell it to you for £1 million. And £1 million in 1883 was like $250 million today. And the world freaked out, but they didn't only freak out because it was so expensive, they freaked out because this particular copy of Deuteronomy may not only have been the oldest copy of the Bible in the world, but in fact was wildly different from the traditional text of the Bible that was read in churches and synagogues each week. And so if the oldest copy of the Bible in the world, and hence probably the most original copy of the Bible in the world, was very different than the copy everybody was used to, well, that had major theological ramifications because it indicated that in some way, the copy of the Bible that we were all used to, or they were all used to at the time, was fraudulent. And that was an explosive proposition. And so Shapira got major league coverage, at the level of celebrity divorce coverage in newspapers.
But what I was going to say is, Hanan's book reveals this world in which you imagine there are people like in an Indiana Jones movie who are searching for the great discovery and knowing they can cash in. And they are sort of, you describe them as sort of part Gatsby, part Indiana Jones. There is something romantic, everything about him begs for a movie to be made about him. But
I hope you're right. From your mouth to God's ear, from your mouth to Spielberg's ears, as my mother didn't say. He was an extremely... He was a roguish character. He was also an extremely romantic character, in part because he's so completely embraced the period of time in which he was living in. It was biblical archaeology at this time was just emerging from the field of, it was sort of a gentlemanly endeavor where rich people from England would come over and try to dig up something and bring it home to show that they were there. It was emerging into a field of science. An increasing number of pilgrims were now, because of steamship travel, were able to descend on Jerusalem and themselves try to dig up a piece of the past and maybe even prove the Bible right. And Shapira was able to recognize this as a business opportunity. With all these folks showing up, he said, hey, I know what they want, and I'm going to give it to them. And the question that ultimately comes up with Shapira is, well, he gave them some authentic stuff, but did he sometimes cross the line and say, well, I really know what they want, and I don't have it, so I'm going to create it? And that's sort of part of the thrust of the book, of course.
I love the first, we get this description, Moses Wilhelm Shapira, archaeological treasure hunter, antiquities maven, inveterate social climber, and by that point, a man painfully down in his luck, believed that the contents of the stylish carpet bag he carried would help repair a once solid reputation that had nearly been destroyed by scandal. And I also, well, I guess I wanted to hear about your sort of growing maybe affection and exasperation, your relationship over the writing of the book with Shapira. At what points were there some areas of identification with him as you began your own journey? How did your relationship grow and develop?
So. Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. I didn't think I was going to end up liking this guy because he got himself into a lot of trouble for dishonesty. Now, as it turns out, he might not have been as dishonest as folks thought he was. Maybe I'll tell a little bit of that story, I think, and then I'll end up at your question, which is that I ended up falling in love with the guy.
You feel it. I mean, I'll tell you where I felt it.
Okay, good. I'm glad you feel it because, I mean, it's exactly sort of the trajectory of my, you know, it was like I was dating this long dead man, which is awkward.
Let me ask. Yeah, go ahead.
For my wife, especially.
Exactly. I wonder, when I'm reading it, I'm wondering if you had the same thing. I start to get I'm not happy with all these people that are taking such great pleasure in taking him down, you know, and it's those people that the way there seems to be a whole bunch of people that just can't wait to pop up, you know, a hole in his.
That's
where you feel like taking up from because he's just getting beat up.
So. He's just getting beat up, and you know, I think in part he was at certain points he was maybe overzealous, but actually was a dupe rather than himself the perpetrator of fraud. But I guess what I should say is that, you know, I started talking about him showing up at the British Museum and asking for £1 million. So, and you know, at that point, he becomes a very, very famous man. The Prime Minister of England, William Ewart Gladstone, shows up at the British Museum in the Oriental Manuscripts Department to shake his famous visitor's hand. And he comes away so astounded by what he's seen that he goes off apparently to try to raise some of the money himself so to make sure that the British Museum gets this and not some other European capital. So Shapira is loving all of this, obviously. In the meantime, the British Museum calls in their own biblical expert, who was himself a Jewish guy who converted to Christianity, a man named Christian David Ginsburg, who was born on Christmas Day in Warsaw. And Ginsburg goes into the bowels of the British Museum, and he toils away, occasionally publishing articles about what he's discovering and publishing sections of, you know, in translation. And amazingly, he's actually publishing bits of this in Hebrew, sort of in Hebrew script, in the mainstream London press, which means that alongside Greek and Latin, folks in England at the time, because there was a great Bible craze, actually knew Hebrew, which I was sort of stunned by. So in any case, Ginsburg is working away, and he comes back 4 weeks later and says, wait, hold your horses, everybody, it's a fake, it's a fraud. And folks are very, very distraught over this, really sad. Shapira is especially distraught, goes off on a six-month bender in Northern Europe, ends up dying 6 months later, and sort of tragic circumstances in Rotterdam. And people thought,
which is where the book starts.
Right, exactly. The book starts with his death. And people thought at the time, well, that's where the story ends. The guy faked this copy of Deuteronomy, tried to sell it to the British Museum, and got caught, and went off and died. But then you fast forward about 70 years, and they discover the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, what I haven't mentioned yet was that Shapira's scrolls were apparently, the story he told, was that they were found by wandering Bedouin in caves near the Dead Sea, and recall that they were full of variant readings from the traditional text, and it was a book of Deuteronomy. Well, the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered by a wandering Bedouin in caves near the Dead Sea, They were full of variant readings, and the second most numerous, the sort of Deuteronomy was the number two book, you know, among in popularity among the Essenes or the Qumran community. And so people 70 years later thought, oh my God, you know, this guy actually discovered the first Dead Sea Scroll 70 years before the rest of them were discovered, and was dismissed as a fraud because it was basically ahead of his time. And so folks in the 1950s started, some scholars said, well, we should go back and investigate and look and see if indeed he did find the first Dead Sea Scroll. And so they tried to, but as it turned out, Shapira's Deuteronomy Scroll disappeared mysteriously in the intervening 70 years.
You don't want to give away everything.
I don't want to give away everything, but I will say that the book is sort of half sort of narrative history about Moses Wilhelm Shapira and half me going around the world searching for these scrolls.
So given all that you said, the best person to begin the journey is a person who's going to write an article on the Bedouin army, Bedouin Arabs who served as trackers for the Israeli military. So that's how you began with this magazine assignment, correct?
Right, exactly.
And then from there, you bail on that, right? And you end up in Jordan, and all of a sudden, and there's this, it becomes, the language starts becoming Hanan as Indiana Jones. You know, there's sort of dodging waterfalls.
The handsome Indiana Jones.
Exactly. Well, he's pretty handsome too.
I'm joking.
But can you tell that, how did you end up in Jordan? You know,
Maybe that might be a good section for me to read, if that's good. Yeah. So maybe I'll read a couple pages here. So the idea was I was writing this article, which I did end up writing, about Arabs who serve in Israel's army. The Bedouin are most numerous among them. But I had just heard this story about Shapira, and I couldn't help but, I was sort of becoming obsessed with this idea. And so I sort of sneaked off from that assignment in Jerusalem and caught a taxi to Jordan. And I will read a few pages of that. So rather than interview Bedouin soldiers that week, I sneaked off to Jordan. Maybe the first clue was hidden where all this began, near the cave where Shapira claimed his scrolls had been discovered. Beginning the day in East Jerusalem, I caught a service taxi in a dank alcove across from the Damascus Gate and rode to the Allenby Bridge, which links the West Bank and Jordan. Due to diplomatic exigencies stemming from the fact that I'm an Israeli citizen, guards there refused me passage. I hired a car to drive me to northern Israel and several hours later, crossed the border at Beit She'an. There I caught another cab south to Madaba, an 80-mile drive on a narrow, poorly maintained road where potholes and bad drivers seemed to be competing to foreshorten my life. A smattering of small towns dotted the route, announced by short strips of decaying shops. At the curbside, men in keffiyehs sold vegetables from white boxes. Trash littered the road. The landscape between these towns can be described in a single word: brown. Though looking west over the border, one could see the rich green of Israeli farms nestled in the Jordan Valley. I arrived at the Mariam Hotel early in the evening and met Benjamin Porter and Bruce Rutledge poolside for drinks. Along with two other archaeologists, Porter and Rutledge directed the Ban Excavation and Development Project at the site where an Anglican missionary had found the Moabite stone in 1868. The next morning, Porter and I set out for the rim of Wadi Mujib, the biblical Arnon, the massive gorge where several Bedouin were supposed to have happened upon Shapira's scrolls. On the way, Porter stopped at Diban to show me his dig. Some archaeological sites, the pyramids in Giza, Petra, are so grand, so evocative, that their import is unmistakable even to the untrained eye. Diban is not one of them. It's hard for a non-specialist to understand much of the site's history as a Moabite settlement without a good imagination and an expert like Porter leading the way. What I remember most vividly is that when we stepped out of his car, he said, "You might want to grab a couple rocks in case the wild dogs show up." We toured the site for about an hour as the sun stood taller and taller. Porter guided me to a makeshift tent to meet the man guarding the site. Salim al-Limon may very well have been the oldest person in the world. His sun-leathered face crinkled like the scrolls I was hunting, a mustache betraying dwindling traces of its original darkness, and a bleach-white keffiyeh exaggerating the narrowness of his head. He carried a wooden stick for walking on the rough terrain, and he was, it quickly became clear, nearly deaf. The idea that he could protect the site from looters was as improbable as a discovery of the Moabite stone, which had been found just a few feet away. Even in the recent past, archaeology in parts of the Middle East was largely divorced from Middle Easterners. Western academics would parachute in to excavate, but did not interact with locals. Since 2004, Porter told me, he and his colleagues have been trying to involve the community in the area surrounding their dig, hiring them, teaching them, trying to understand how they see the sites where these foreigners are digging. Al-Limon had been hired with this noble goal in mind, and he'd been selected precisely because he was old. "We often think the children will respect an old man," Porter explained. "If an old man starts hitting you with a stick, you'll stop what you're doing. But there's a flip side. The older guys also won't listen to you," he said. "They sleep a lot and let goats trample and shit on the excavation." Shortly after I left, Al-Limon was fired. By the time we arrived at Wadi Mujib, the sun was so intense that it played tricks on the eyes. Huge mountains seemed to bleed one into the next, creating the impression of a single monolith broken only by the occasional blue-green of a desert pool. But the shimmering sun could not hide a series of gaps in the face of steep cliffs overlooking the canyon. These, Porter told me, were caves. He pointed toward Arair, the town nearest the Shapira cave, and told me that the scrolls could have survived had sediment traveled down the mountainside and sealed the cave, protecting it from the damp outside. Other important manuscripts had been shielded in this way, including the Dead Sea Scrolls. Colluvial erosion, as this process is known, is responsible for caves opening and closing repeatedly over thousands of years. Open, their interiors are exposed to the elements. Closed, caves are an environment in which organic material can survive. Given the heat and the lunar landscape that stretched out in all directions, it was hard to imagine that damp weather was ever an issue out here. "In fact," said Porter, who wore a baseball cap, sunglasses, and a blue shirt with its collar turned up against the heat, "the wadi is known for flash flooding, from pounding storms that come out of nowhere and drench the river basin. Even so," he told me, "if Shapira had faked the scrolls, this would have been a good place to claim they'd been found. No one could double-check Shapira's work," he said. "It was the Wild West out here." Earlier the next day, I headed down into the wadi itself. The taxi ride from Madaba was desolate, russet hills undulating from the car to the horizon, decorated periodically by a sturdy Bedouin tent made from burlap coffee sacks, stamped "product of El Salvador." The last half hour was an unrelenting descent, steep and winding, until at last we stopped at the mouth of the wadi and parked. At 1,350 feet below sea level, we had reached what was nearly the lowest spot on Earth. At the entrance, I walked past the guard desk, and the man sitting behind it said, "Is that what you're wearing?" I looked down at what my brother calls my journalist costume. Long army pants, a khaki button-down, and boots. "Yes," I said. He shrugged and waved me through. A moment later, I caught sight of my driver walking briskly by me in his sneakers and underwear. Almost as soon as we stepped into the wadi's approach, I understood. Entry was through a narrow gorge, steep red-brown cliffs rising starkly on either side and climbing 100 or more feet into the sky. As I headed in, a channel of green water, 2 or 3 inches deep, trickled out toward the Dead Sea. The gorge narrowed quickly, blocking out the sun. Pushing forward, I found myself high-stepping through water that was now a foot deep. The farther I walked, the deeper it became. After about 300 yards, I was in water up to the collar of my very inappropriate shirt. I looked over at my driver, who was luxuriating in his boxers. "Flood," he said. Then he smiled and swam ahead. We hiked this way for 2 hours, scaling rocks and dodging waterfalls in the dark, flooded passageway. But it was all for nothing. The current became too rough, and we had to turn around. Heading back, I recalled the scene in 2 Kings, when the armies of Israel, Judah, and Edom joined forces to quell the Moabites. As troops circled the Dead Sea's southern tip, not far from where I walked, their water ran out. Panicked, they called in the prophet Elisha, who prophesied that dry pools would fill miraculously. Suddenly, I appreciated how that might have occurred. I also understood what Shapira's critics had charged late in the 19th century, that the wadi was too damp for the scrolls to have survived. Drenched, the driver and I rode back to Madaba in our underwear. Let's stop there. Thank you.
So in case you think it was all, you know, sort of swashbuckling, there's also scenes of Hanan eating scones and drinking coffee as he waits in an auction house.
Yeah. You know, like, so I put on a lot of weight during this.
Yeah, there you go. But this, you began this kind of detective trail, and if you could talk a little bit about the fun of that. You're not just writing a book, but you've become a detective, and you allow the reader, as you write it, to join us in that same, we're alongside you asking the same questions. And so there's an auction item that's put up for sale by Bernard Quaritch, right, who'd bought it from Sotheby's, right? And then there's the letter by Christian David Ginsburg, and I love this. Ginsburg's great-grandson makes James Bond films.
Yes.
Right? Which is, there's all these great, and then you run into this Yoram Sabo, who's also a filmmaker. So there's, and the thing that ties everyone together, so I want you to go through that trail a little bit, is, and I don't know if you came up with this term or if someone else, I think it's Yoram Sabo, right, who calls them Shapira maniacs,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
So that the idea of being that obsessed that you become a Shapira.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a hypochondriac, so the idea that I had another condition
that you become
was actually
a Shapira
very disturbing
as
for
well.
Me at some point.
But
yeah,
but yeah, maybe begin with that auction item, you know, and then like that trail there. That
sure. So after Shapira died, we know what happened to his scroll sort of immediately afterwards. They only disappeared later. So what happened was they were put on auction by Sotheby's. At Sotheby's, these scrolls that were once valued at £1 million were purchased by a book dealer in London named Bernard Quaritch for £10.5. He then goes ahead and lists them in his catalogs a couple of times. He displays them at something called the Anglo-Jewish Historical Exhibition at the Royal Albert Hall in 1887. And then after that, kaput. No one knows what happened to them at all. And so my search for all this, and I'm glad that you mentioned that sort of the reader is along the way, because that's sort of what I wanted everyone to feel, that you were learning things as I was learning things. Because as I was going along on this hunt, I sort of, at many points, I forgot I was writing a book. I just sort of became obsessed with trying to track down these scrolls.
But it's the other thing that seems to come out is you've uncovered this community, you know, like that's spread all over the world, because you've got, yeah, of all with the same obsession.
Yeah.
But the nice thing is you have to feel like you're one of them at this point.
That's so, yes, absolutely, yeah. I do. So there's this term Shapira maniacs, right? People have been obsessed with this guy for years and years. And it's sort of odd, right? He died in 1884, a really long time ago. And yet I discovered as I was traipsing around the world trying to find these scrolls, that there were two Israeli documentary filmmakers making films about him at the very time I was writing this book. There's apparently an English author who's currently writing a book about Shapira. And then there's this host of other people who aren't sort of working on large projects, but they are in their own small way trying to figure out, you know, trying to understand the mystery. And so I became one of them. And it was, in some ways, that was comforting, because I sort of felt part of this community. I also thought, oh, I've got these people I can talk to and ask questions to. The flip side of that coin was they were all my competitors. And as it turned out, they certainly saw me as their competitor. So one of the Israeli filmmakers, who doesn't really appear much in the book, he and I were supposed to work, you know, we agreed to work together a little bit and share information. As it turned out, I did most of the sharing of information and then never heard from him again. Then there's another filmmaker named Yoram Sabo,
yeah,
who at the beginning was extremely generous to me
with
his material.
He sounded intense.
Yeah, he was an intense guy. This guy had been searching for Shapira scrolls for 30 years when I showed up on the scene. So I'm this young whippersnapper, and he's been at it forever. And so I first call him on the phone, and I say, hey, here's what I'm doing. And he says, another Shapira maniac. And I thought, oh, wow, so there's a name for it. And then he said to me something which is really interesting. He said, well, I'm either going to give you everything I have or I'm going to give you nothing.
Right. I love that line.
Yeah.
That's great.
You know,
that's the fork in the road, right?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Well, and so, but it turns out he wasn't being quite honest with me, because he gave me everything once. So he sort of plugged his thumb drive into my laptop when we first met with his PowerPoint presentation about what he discovered so far. And then about 6 months later, we were in a little bit of contact, and then he basically cut off all contact with me. He decided, I think, that I was, you know, I'm not sure what he decided. I don't know if he decided at first he thought I was kind of a joke, and he was way so far ahead that there was no way I'd ever catch up, and so it didn't matter, and maybe at some point he changed his mind. But as my uncle, who's a journalist, said when I was saying to him, you know, I don't know what to do. This guy's been doing it for 30 years. I've got this book contract, and he's going to discover it before I do, and I'm going to be finished. And he said, well, if he's been searching for 30 years, my guess is you're probably going to catch up to him. And ultimately, that's what happened.
You know, there's sort of, I can feel the kind of high points and low points, right? And there's a kind of a low point surrounding what you find out about the Nicholson fire, right? Is kind of a low point. And then there's a series of letters that sort of picks you up out of that mood, you know?
Yeah.
So it's, did you feel those highs and lows, you know, feeling like all of a sudden you've hit a dead end and maybe this isn't going to yield anything and what am I doing and I'm lost, and then suddenly you get and you find it out of the in an unlikely place, suddenly all these doors open up. So
yeah, I mean, it was a roller coaster of emotion for me. You know, genuinely it was. I would come up with some theory, make some discovery, and I think this is it, I'm finally there, and I beat everybody else and thank God for it. And then I would realize that it was just a dead end for me. And I'd just be there. You know, there's a scene there which is totally true. I was just sort of sitting on my couch eating Fruit Loops from a huge bowl, kind of depressed about the whole thing. And at that particular point, I get an email out of the blue from a guy in Australia named Matthew Hamilton, who says, sort of very enigmatically, "I'm just wondering if you had any success finding the Shapira scrolls. Best, Matthew." And so I wrote back and I said, "You know, well, I've got this book coming out," and I didn't want to tell him anything because I didn't know who he was. And I said, "You know, why are you asking?" And he wrote back and said, "Well, I've been working on Shapira for about a decade, and I happened to have discovered who actually bought Shapira scrolls after the trail went cold. So I know the name of the person." And this was, by the way, on Erev Yom Kippur. So I was literally on my way out the door to go to synagogue. And I thought, oh my God, it's a sign it's a sign from God. So I prayed hard that night. But then he, too, dropped off the face of the planet. He wrote this tantalizing email, dropped this bombshell that would have broken my search wide open at a moment that I had really just hit a brick wall. I'd been doing it for years. This was sort of I thought it was finished. I was going to have to write this book with no, you know, I was going to write the end on page 111 or something. Mm-hmm. And then I get this, and I was so excited, and he just disappears completely. And so at that point, 8 months of my trying to track him down, trying to get in touch with him, and he won't get back in touch with me. And so my choice was either write the end, i.e. literally the end, or go to Australia and try to find this guy. The problem was, all I had for him was an email address. So it's hard to find someone via their email address, it turns out.
Australia's only got like 10 or 15 people.
Yeah, that's true. But they're very spread out. So I hired a private eye in Australia to try to find him. And they, after about 2 weeks, sent me back, I think it was like a 67-page report on the guy, with almost no information. I mean, it was the least detailed 67-page report you've ever seen in your life. But what it did include was two bits of information. One was that years ago he was a librarian at an Anglican college in Australia, in outside Sydney. And the second thing was an address where he lived 6 years earlier. And I thought, this is very strange, and now there's no privacy anymore anywhere, and yet we cannot find this man. And so I figured, all right, well, this is a shot in the dark, but I'm going for it. So I bought a ticket to Sydney, and I had no idea what I was going to do when I got there. But on the plane, I was reviewing the 67-page dossier, trying to find something that spoke to me anew after having read it several times. And that's when I saw the thing that, oh, wait, he taught at an Anglican college. That must mean he's Anglican, right? So where's the best place to find an Anglican on Sunday morning when I was landing in Australia? Well, church. So the minute I got to my hotel room, I Googled Anglican church and the name of the neighborhood where he had lived 6 years earlier. And I found one. And so I caught a taxi. I put on a tie, and I didn't quite know how to dress for it. I actually ended up going to more churches than the papal nuncio, I think, during this trip. So I show up in the church. It turns out it's no longer an Anglican church. And no one there had ever heard of Matthew Hamilton, but down the street there's a Presbyterian church. So I walk down the street to the Presbyterian church, and I kind of peek in, and a lady comes out, and she says, "Can I help you?" And I explain to her a little bit what I'm there for. She's like, "Let me go inside." And she said, "I haven't seen Matthew Hamilton in 20 years, but I'm going to go inside, and someone here might be able to help you." So she brings out a guy who turns out to have been Matthew Hamilton's pastor 20 years ago. I was thanking my lucky stars. And I don't want to give away too much here, except to say he was very excited about this American writer coming to find a copy of the Bible. And so he was like, "All right, get in my car." And he and I started driving around Greater Sydney trying to track down Matthew Hamilton. I guess I won't tell you what happened in the end, but that was it was fantastic.
Well, there's a line later on in the book, I think, in which you say that Moses Shapira would have liked to hear that this particular person, professor you're describing, was taking up sort of on his side in terms of making. And I wonder if you had the sense that he was rooting for you in some way, that like somewhere he was out there really pleased at what you were
doing. I did, for sure. Mostly because he was a guy who would have loved to have a book written about him. Mm-hmm. It takes a certain amount of hubris to write an autobiography, for example. And I think he's the kind of guy who would have done that had he survived. And so in some way, I felt like I was completing work that he would have wanted to do. Now, he might not necessarily agree with my conclusions. He probably wouldn't have liked some of my descriptions of him. He was a social climber in many ways. He was roguish in many ways. He was dishonest in many ways.
Sounds like some of our most successful people. Yeah.
I think it's politicians.
Yeah, and that too.
But he was also incredibly intelligent, incredibly creative. He was a family man. He had sort of pulled himself up from the bootstraps. He'd showed up in Jerusalem utterly impoverished and made himself sort of the most successful antiquities dealer there.
Yeah, and he had a lot of, there are previous discoveries that he made that had been authenticated, right? I mean, he had a decent track record going into this.
Right, you know? So, you know, that his record was mixed.
Right.
Right, so there was, on the one hand, he had lots of inarguably authentic manuscripts, for example, that, biblical manuscripts that he had brought over from Yemen that were hundreds of years old and very valuable, and some of the biggest museums in the world were his clients. The British Museum had been his client for these manuscripts, the Royal Library in Berlin, among other places. And yet there was this other side to him where he had gotten involved in a scandal where the Pergamon Museum in Berlin had bought 3,000 supposedly ancient Moabite statuettes from him for a large amount of money. He had sort of become fairly wealthy from the deal, and then it turned out that those were fraudulent. But that was one of those cases where I started describing before, where he ultimately, he was sort of the dupe. People had brought him this stuff and claimed they'd uncovered it in Moab, and he just believed them and sold it and made a lot of money. Ultimately, it was all fake. His record was mixed, but when he showed up in 1883 at the British Museum with supposedly the oldest copy of the Bible in the world, he wasn't unknown to them. He had been actually one of their most important purveyors of old biblical manuscripts up to this point. And so by that point, they had already put aside the scandals of the past and were treating him as sort of a respected antiquities dealer.
So I have two separate questions, but I want to start with this, which comes off of that. There's this paragraph I liked on page 36. You say, "History is a fickle thing, as are those who record it. This is why men like Shapira exist. Antiquities dealers, archaeologists, and other connoisseurs who trade in hard evidence, that you have trading in hard evidence of the ancient past, thrive because humans by nature are proof seekers." That idea, of like this obsession with proof. "Faith goes far, but without tangible evidence for one's beliefs, the nails of the true cross, the shroud of Turin, Noah's Ark, a great chasm emerges that can flood with doubt. These history merchants provide links to glorious past, commoditizing authenticity," which I think in many ways is what your book is about. "Sometimes they do one better and offer confirmation for deeply held convictions. In searching for Shapira's scrolls, I suppose I was looking for something similar."
Yeah.
But that idea of that constant search for proof, and the relationship between doubt and faith and proof, especially when something, it's an article of faith, right?
So that's right.
It's complicated, but that seems to be so much of what this is about.
So yeah. It is completely. I mean, so Shapira wouldn't have existed without this desire among religious people of several religions to hold in their hands an authentic piece of the past, right? To prove the Bible right. But ultimately, that's exactly what I was doing in a way. I was looking for proof to say, are these things real? Were these scrolls real or were they fake? And so I felt a kinship with him. I felt a kinship with all the people who sort of existed in Jerusalem at the time, who were flooding the holy city, trying to bring home relics. In a way, it seems like a kind of quixotic thing, but then I guess seeking proof is always in its way, quixotic. I guess faith begins where proof ends, sort of. And we all, I talked to at the very end of the book. I interviewed a few people, and I said, "Why do we search for this stuff?" I talked to some Noah's Ark hunters, for example, who have been doing it for years and years and haven't found the Ark yet, as it turns out. The guy said, "Well, let me answer that question by telling you a story." Guy shows up at a frozen lake on his horse. And he stops at the foot of it, and he doesn't know if he can go across the lake because he's not sure if the frozen water will hold both him and his horse. So as he's standing there pondering this question, a team of about 15 horses buzzes by him and runs across the lake, and they don't crash through, and they're fine. And so he decides, okay. And he just jumps on his horse, and he goes across. And he said, "Well, what changed from the time where he didn't know if he could make it across to the time where he left?" And he said, "Well, now we had some evidence. He had some proof." And said that's what he's out there doing as a Noah's Ark hunter. You know, he said something to the effect of, you know, I think one of the Gospels, or someone said, if the resurrection did not occur, then we're all fools. Something along that line. And so he said what he's out there trying to do is to prove the resurrection occurred. And I think that's what a lot of people who are out there relic hunting are doing. They're trying to find evidence that these things that they believe but don't yet have proof for are in fact authentic.
And to have these documents that were written at the time the events occurred, which is... I had a separate question, which is, I was wondering if you had thought, or if you could sort of think now, how would Shapira have lived out his days had everything gone smoothly? Had it been authenticated and he got his money, what would he have done with his... Would there be more discoveries? How... You know, what
he would have bought a basketball team.
Clearly.
That's such a good question, Tom. And it's funny, I would have thought a lot about that, but I didn't, because I knew he didn't make it.
Well, because it's so sad what does happen. But what, you know, how that feeling when the money's going to come in, you know, when everything's going to turn out okay for him. How does the rest of his life go?
Yeah, I mean, and you're exactly right. I mean, while he was off in London being celebrated, his wife and daughter were back home in Jerusalem blowing tons of money on credit because they were about to become the richest people in Jerusalem. And ultimately, that didn't happen. You know, I think what he really wanted in his life was respect. And he particularly wanted respect from the academic class. He was not himself sort of formally educated man. I think he was educated, we don't know this for sure, but he was probably educated in yeshivas back in the Pale of Settlement. He studied a little English when he got to Jerusalem, but he wasn't a man of great formal learning, although he was extremely knowledgeable in ancient Hebrew texts. And so you can see in the letters that he writes to academics, you know, he's on one hand, he's a pompous guy. Sorry, I have to fix the Madonna mic. You know, he's a pompous guy who really a showman who, when people come into his store, he'd always invite the pretty ladies to the special back room and he'd spray a mist of rose water on them. And he'd say, this is where Bathsheba bathed and David saw her nude and, you know, had her husband killed. And he'd really put on a show. And yet, when he would write letters to other academics, he was extremely deferential. He was completely aware of his place in the academic hierarchy. So he had both these things going for him, but I think what he really wanted to do was to be seen by other academics as a man, a serious man, a man of great learning, a man who discovers important things and brings them into the world. And so my guess is that had this thing been sold and became rich, he probably would have, you know, sought out some kind of impressive academic appointment in Europe, or possibly some sort of role as a consul for someone somewhere. And you know, something where when he walked into a room, people really had to be deferential to him.
And two things I think of when you say that. One is the sort of exquisite pain you must feel of the humiliation in the eyes of academics and everybody who he wanted the respect from.
Yeah.
And also how you could have seen Gatsby in him. You know, that sense of social striving.
Yes, exactly.
And humiliation and all. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's right. And you know, it's funny, that sense of humiliation, remarkably, has... I actually tracked down a member of his family in rural Germany in a town called Schlitz, which is not actually where they make the beer, as it turns out. And they are still aggrieved by the whole thing, which I found just remarkable. And so, you know, it really touched me. It really, really touched me to see that they still see the whole thing as a massive injustice perpetrated on their long-dead relative. And I went to visit the house where his wife, Shapira's wife, ultimately ended up living after he died and where she died, and I went to her gravesite, and I just felt sadness, and I felt how his wife must have felt this sadness every single day of her life afterwards. You know, this terrible thing had happened to her husband, and I'm sure she felt it could have been avoided, and that was really heartbreaking.
So for the budding or current writers in the room, I know there are several. Can you talk a little bit about putting the book together? At what point were you writing the book all along? Were you keeping journals? Was when did it start getting? When did you sort of figure out the way you would the story would unfold, how the narrative would?
I began by writing. So my initial thing was, I'm not going to start writing until I figure out the answer. Right? Were these real or were they fake? Did I find them or did I not? And then I realized that might never happen, which would mean I would never write the book. And so I began writing along the way, and I wrote in, hotel rooms and cafes and stuff everywhere I went. So this book was written just sort of all over the world. And if you look at my laptop, you can see it's taken a beating. So there were a few struggles, though, in figuring out how to structure the book. So on the one hand, as I said, there's this historical narrative portion about Moses Wilhelm Shapira and the era in which he lived. And on the other hand is my own search for these scrolls. Now, in order for the reader to care about and understand my own search for the scrolls, well, the reader has to know something about the scrolls. They have to know, for example, what they were. They have to know that they were deemed fraudulent. They have to know that Shapira died, which means I sort of have to give away the end of the story at the very beginning.
But that's not the end of the story. The way you do it. It's not that he died. It's the truth or not truth. I mean, there's so much that's still in suspense that we don't know.
That's right. But the idea specifically that they were deemed fraudulent.
Right.
My initial thought was I really don't want that to come till page 200 or something like that. But then I realized it was impossible because and the fact that the scrolls went missing, I had to let everyone know. And I realized it's impossible to keep that till page 200 because then what am I searching for?
Yeah.
I had to figure out exactly how to structure that, so that was a bit of a challenge. The other thing was, there was actually remarkably little documentary evidence left behind of Moses Wilhelm Shapira. So if you're a presidential biographer, you've got literally buildings full of boxes of files and papers, and your job there is to go through all of it and figure out what's really important and what can be left out. I had the opposite problem, which is that there was sort of a paucity of material, and I had to travel endlessly around the world just to find, a single letter that the guy wrote. And how to take that little bit of material and turn that into sort of a round, living human being on the page. And what that meant for me was sort of reading everything that Shapira wrote very, very deeply, which was to say not only for facts and figures, but also to try to understand in everything he wrote what was his frame of mind? What was his state of mind at the time he wrote this? Why was he writing this? What were his motives in writing this? And so that sort of thinking helped me take the material and turn it into a person. Now, the danger there is that when you have a sort of very little bit of information, you want to use every last bit of information that you discover in your book. You don't want anything to go to waste. But then when you do that, that's when you start writing lines like, and that summer, Shapira ate his first avocado because, you found some letter where he mentioned an avocado or something. And that's really boring because who cares when he ate his first avocado? On the one hand, you want to include all the best stuff. On the other hand, you have to fight the urge to not put in every last darn detail that you discover.
Do you know the Borges story, Shakespeare's Memory?
I don't.
So a guy wins Shakespeare's Memory at a bar, I guess, but he thinks it's all going to be the good stuff, but it's also every mundane thing. And so he's actually surprised.
Boring.
Yeah. Well, summer's great. And
yeah.
Summer's the avocado.
So. Yeah, exactly.
And then how about the way in which you kind of capture texture, in time periods that you aren't, the scenes, the street scenes in Jerusalem. How does one do that? I guess you find these details and then just dream your way into it the way you do with fiction, I guess?
I tried not to do too much dreaming because I really wanted it to be accurate. Yeah. In fiction, that's one of the great things about fiction is you can dream. On the other hand, because the options are endless, I think it can be paralyzing. And with nonfiction, I really wanted to stick sort of just to the facts. And so, to figure out what Jerusalem was like in the 19th century, I just read loads of books. I looked at loads of pictures. I interviewed historians who were far more expert than I was. From there, you do gather a lot of information, and then you really have the opportunity to choose the best little details that really, I think, evoke what it was like there. And one of the surprising things for me was that Jerusalem at the time was actually not a very good place for a Jew to be living. It's hard to imagine that nowadays a little bit. But the fact is, at the time, it was, you know, there was, the Jews were sort of lowest on the socioeconomic ladder. They lived in sort of filthy neighborhoods. They relied on charity from abroad just to eat. And Jerusalem as a whole, it was sort of a stinking backwater of the Ottoman Empire, which was crumbling at the time. Cholera sort of lurked everywhere. As I say in the book, it was not a very inspiring singles scene for a man like Shapira. So, you know, that was surprising for me. But that was some of my favorite stuff. I was born in Jerusalem, and it's a city I love. And so to be able to, you know, really go back and dig up what it was like back in this, you know, back in this time period. And it was, I should say that this was an incredibly important time period because it was right at, you know, Jerusalem was sort of a forgotten place at the time. And in the mid-19th century, as these, as steamships and train travel became more prominent and access became easier, loads and loads of people from the United States, from Europe, started descending on Jerusalem. And so it was at that point that it went from stinking backwater to destination. And so that's when the city really began to get cleaned up and began to get modernized, and consulates from abroad started establishing presences there. And there, so because of that, there were consuls from Europe and spies and antiquities dealers and, you know, all sorts of pilgrims from abroad. So it was a really, really dynamic place. And that was the exact milieu in which a guy like Shapira could thrive.
Right. I was wondering the decision that you made to put yourself, you know, in the story, and then what your thinking was behind. In my nonfiction book, I'd written a bunch of really dry pages, and then I remember my wife saying, "You should write it as you," you know. And so I started to write it from my perspective because I actually knew all these people, and I was writing this story. And then I took a lot of the things about me out, but I kept the voice. Yours, it's infused with your voice and your sensibility, but you're actually in there. But I'm wondering, what, you know, how much of you did you want in? Did you ever get to a point where you thought you'd give more of your family history and more stuff that you decided ultimately was extraneous? How did you decide to put just the amount of you in the book that's there?
Yeah. It's a really good question. The truth is, I came up as a journalist, and so I'm completely uncomfortable writing about myself. You know, it was totally verboten to say I did anything in anything I ever wrote. And in fact, a couple of the, you know, like reviews and things have mentioned the word memoir with regard to certain sections here. And it literally, that thought never once occurred to me as I was writing the book, that I was in any way doing anything memoir-like. I don't know if that was some kind of block or what. But I didn't, you know, when I wrote the proposal for the book, the thing about searching for the missing scrolls was about one line, because I didn't want to oversell it. I didn't know if I was going to fail or succeed. I didn't want to make it like that was the basis of the book, because then if I didn't find anything and it wasn't interesting and the people I met weren't interesting along the way, you know, then the book is
You'd
a total failure.
You'd be in the same boat as Shapira.
What, sorry?
You'd be in the same boat
right,
as Shapira.
Right, exactly. So yeah. But then I remember I went in to meet the publisher after, you know, after they bought the book. And he sat me down and he said, "So, do you think you're going to find them?" It was the first thing he said, and that's when I thought, oh my God, I'm in deep, deep trouble now.
He took one look at you, Hanan, and that's when he got the whole Indiana Jones idea.
Exactly. He said, "Buy a razor, for God's sake." And so I didn't initially think I was going to be in the book very much, but as this, as my search went on and as I got increasingly obsessed by it, I sort of realized there was no way to do it without including myself.
It doesn't work without.
Right.
I mean, because you have to join that community. You
right.
You have
that's
to
exactly
be one
it.
Of the Shapira maniacs.
Right. Just exactly.
Yeah.
I had to become a Shapira maniac.
I am too now. So.
God bless you. I'm going to put that on the back of the paperback. Yeah. I mean, that was exactly it. And as I said before, I wanted people reading it to sort of be on my shoulder the whole way, making the discoveries as I was making the discoveries. So, I don't know that I'll ever write another book that includes myself, because I'm still not comfortable with it. But, you know, a question like, did I ever think I was going to include more or less or whatever, it was always, you know, my editor saying, you have to talk a little bit more about yourself here so mm-hmm. people understand who is this person doing the searching. I hope there's not too much of it, but I also hope there's enough that folks understand who's looking.
Just the act of beginning the tale at your family dinner table creates this ballast. There's something about having that as the backdrop for the whole story that makes it more tender, and I think it's such an important part of how the book gets told, and I can't imagine it without so much of you.
Thank you for saying that. That part was, it was really important for me, that because my father spent 16 years of his life writing a commentary on the book of Deuteronomy, and I said somewhere, you know, it was the word Deuteronomy in my house growing up was like saying peanut butter and jelly in like most normal houses. We heard that term constantly, every day. It was, you know, a sort of cornerstone of my life. And so when I came upon this story that was about Deuteronomy, and I thought, hey, maybe I can find the original copy of Deuteronomy. And I just sort of imagined calling my parents up and saying, hey, guys, I found it. How amazing that would be.
Send a little on your phone, yes.
Yeah, exactly. And so for me, it was personal in that way. And so beginning there was, I mean, that's where it began anyway. But it did feel appropriate to how I felt about the whole project.
That's great. Well, I've been told that we have some time to invite some, is that right, Stephanie? A few minutes for questions from the audience? So.
Don't be embarrassed to be first.
So, did Ginsburg say why he thought it was a fake?
Yes. I don't want to get into too many of the technical aspects because it would take me forever to describe, but I'll say a few things. The main contention at the time was that leather could not possibly have survived 2,000 or 3,000 years in the environment where they supposedly were discovered. So that was one of the contentions. Of course, the Dead Sea Scrolls ultimately proved that was completely false. A lot of them had to do with grammar. There were weird grammatical usages. There were errors. There was one time where two letters were switched so that God was not angry but was committing adultery. so, you know, Ginsburg pointed this out. And as I say, you know, I was wondering who's the lucky lady. that sort of thing. There was also physical evidence that they saw that seemed to indicate. I don't want to say too much because I don't want to give it away.
It's in the book.
But it's definitely in there. And you know, so it was parchment couldn't survive, weird grammar, words that, you know, Hebrew words that actually didn't come into the lexicon, the Hebrew lexicon, until long after these scrolls purportedly had been written. So it was as if Shakespeare used the word, you know, he said like it was totally awesome, man, or something like that. You know, just really weird, really weird. Yeah, exactly.
He did say that.
He didn't.
At the time, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the real ones, were found in 1947. Had the Shapira story sort of been dormant for 20 or 30 or 40 years, and did the discovery of what were authenticated Dead Sea Scrolls lead to early Shapira mania?
Yeah, great question. So basically, Shapira was a distant memory at the time the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered. Almost no one was still alive. I don't think anyone was still alive who had actually been involved in the whole scandal. There were probably a few people who remembered that it had happened. But largely, it wasn't being written about anymore. There was no scholarship being written about it at the time. It had basically been forgotten and was dormant. And then the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered. And some scholars who knew the story, because among biblical scholars, this is like something that happened in 1883 is basically current events. And so these guys all knew about Shapira. They weren't doing anything about it, but they were all aware of it. And one man in particular, a scholar named Menachem Mansour, who was the head of the Jewish Studies Department at the University of Wisconsin, he heard about this. He heard about this, the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and he thought, well, my goodness, you know, maybe Shapira discovered the first Dead Sea Scroll. I should go back and look. And so he was the first guy who returned to the British Museum and started really looking there. And in fact, I think it was 1953, there was a front page story in the New York Times that had this, you know, really like amazing lead to the story that sounded like the log line for a movie or something. It said, you know, American scholar reopens investigation into, you know, dead antiquities dealer discovery of the first Dead Sea Scroll. And at that point, it became huge news. It was on the front page of the Times. The BBC interviewed this guy, Mansour, and then it became an international story again. But they looked for it. You know, he looked for it, and some other people looked for it, and they couldn't find him. So the story basically ended there. Until, for whatever reason, I came along, two Israeli documentary filmmakers came along, and a writer from England came along, you know, 50 years later and started looking again.
Right over here?
Yes.
So did you have actually a dual mission in your mind? You were looking for the fake, quote, faked scrolls,
mm-hmm.
and also perhaps hoping that you would find some scrolls that had never been discovered?
Not really. I mean, what I really wanted to do was find the Shapira scrolls. And the truth is, I didn't even care so much about finding the Shapira scrolls as much as I cared about proving whether or not they had been real or fake, you know, authentic or not, and whether or not he had ultimately sort of had his life ruined by an error or by something that was in fact factual. And what I will say, I'm going to give a little tantalizing detail, was that, or at least I think it is, I ultimately was, I think, able to prove whether or not they were real or fake. And I made the most important discovery along that line in San Francisco. And not only in San Francisco, but on the fifth floor of the J. Paul Leonard Library of San Francisco State University, where I teach, utterly by happenstance.
Which proves no matter where you go, there's no place like home.
Exactly. That's right.
Has the obsession let go of you? What will you do now? Will you continue to look? Will you leave it to your competitors? How do you think you might write about it in the future?
Now I'm going to buy a basketball team, I think. Or maybe I'll play in the NBA.
Shapira's childhood, perhaps.
Yeah, exactly. a prequel. You know, I think I'm finished with this now. I will say I wake up in the middle of the night thinking, you know, someone is going to, well, I don't want to give, never mind. Then it would give it away. I worry about other people still working on it, you know, where somehow they make some discovery and all of a sudden my book is like, they're like, what was that schmuck thinking? but the next thing I'm working on is a book about antiquities looting in the Middle East after the Arab Spring. So once the dictators in those countries fell, it became the Wild West out there again, and the looting is crazy, and it's sort of really, really terrible for archaeology. So I'm sort of focusing on one particular story in Egypt. Yes?
Was there a point at which you realized that the search for the manuscript was actually besides the point, and what the book was really about was your journey and the experience, and if so, how did that change the way you thought about the narrative?
Oh man, that's a good question. I never felt it was beside... Okay, so for me personally, it was never beside the point. It was always what I wanted to accomplish. But for the book, I think ultimately I realized that whether or not I made these discoveries, it had to be interesting. You know, the journey itself did have to be interesting to people. And so I think that realization, you know, came several years in when I had been failing over and over to make the discoveries I was hoping. But what I was realizing along the way was that that in fact, as cheesy as it is to say it's about the journey, it's not about the destination. In fact, the journey was really interesting because of the people I met, because of the things I discovered, because of the places I went. And so, yeah, I mean, ultimately, I think for the book, that might be beside the point, although I was pretty psyched when I was able to, you know, prove what I set out to prove.
But
sorry, Tom. One thing I should also say is that I'd actually written the entire book, and I only made the discovery that allowed me to solve the thing 8 days before it was due. And so I actually had to go and rewrite the entire ending of the book in a very, very short period of time. And so I think I started thinking it was beside the point, maybe in a self-serving way, because I hadn't made a discovery like that. And then once I did, I realized, okay, there's the end of the book. I know where this thing is going now.
But it might be because your Shapira mania is healthier and tied into a successful book. Well, what I'm saying is, you know, there's a Paul Auster story, right, I think, in the New York trilogy, where it's about a guy who's staring at, or his job as a detective is to look in and watch these people, and he does it for about 3 months, and eventually he realizes the story isn't about those people, it's about him losing his life. Well, so, and I'm thinking about people like Yoram Sabo, and like, that is sort of the story, these people who cease, who are so obsessed with another person's life that it's more central and paramount than their own in some way. But
that's right, and that's how it really felt with him in particular. Because, I mean, imagine spending, maybe some of you have done this, but 30 years of your life trying to track down the truth about one guy who died 100 years ago. his wife, he told me, like, literally thinks he's insane. And mine might think the same of me, I'm not sure. And so it's, you know, it becomes an obsession, and but there's nothing you can really do about obsessions. That's why they're obsessions. And so,
except write a book.
Right, exactly. That's how I, that was,
that's the healthy way. Yeah.
This is how I dealt with it without medication.
Oh, thank you. So given what's going on the campus at present, I think that if it's possible for you to create an exhibit that we could show in the Student Center about your book, that would have a very positive impact.
Well, I'll say this. I see some of the staff from the library, the Sutro Library, which is where I made the discovery here, and they were very, very helpful to me and are thanked in the book because they were so helpful. They have put up a display of some of the treasures that are in the Shapira collection in the Sutro Library right now.
The Sutro Library is kind of hidden. You have to make an effort to go to look at that. And I would like to do something that would hit you in the face when you walk into the Student Center.
I'm game for hitting people in the face, so we can talk afterwards.
Great idea.
But yeah, I think it's a great idea. But I should also, I just want to say that, so the Sutro Library has a collection of 167, I believe is the number of manuscripts that once belonged to Moses Wilhelm Shapira in his collection when he died. And they are a gem sitting in the middle of San Francisco. And they are important, they are unusual, they are rare, they are beautiful. I brought a scholar in there from Israel who looked at them and was utterly astonished and wanted, he said, I need to like get funding to come here for 6 months. So it's an incredible blessing to have, you know, to have that there, and I encourage everyone to go see the exhibit that's there now on the fifth floor, so you can get a sense of what's in the collection. But it's amazing that this thing exists in the middle of our city. They're largely biblical manuscripts from Yemen, some of them, you know, 400, 500, 600 years old, incredibly rare copies of Maimonides, birthing charms from that community. It's just amazing, amazing stuff. So it's really, really cool that it's here. And I just couldn't, when I found out that they had Shapira's manuscripts like 100 yards from my office, just blew my mind.
We're going to take one more question, and then I'm just going to remind everybody we're going to have a book signing immediately afterwards in the back.
You mentioned Ginsburg actually write articles about the scroll, and actually these pieces from the scroll, maybe he did make copies of the scroll, complete copies somewhere.
Yeah, so all of Ginsburg's notes and documents and sketches about the scrolls are now in a file numbered 41294 at the British Library. It's sort of the font of, you know, the, that's ground zero for Shapira-related research. He did, in fact, have some kind of artist sketch them exactly as they were. Only one of those pieces, you know, those sketches still exists. No one knows what the heck happened. So everything that Shapira touched eventually disappears, usually in a fire somehow. So Ginsburg did, in fact, make sketches and transcriptions, but the sketches, unfortunately, largely don't survive. And in any event, a sketch is an interpretation, right? It's how the artist is seeing it. It's never 100% accurate. And so you can determine a certain amount from looking at a sketch of these things, but I don't think you could have made a judgment, yay or nay, just by looking at that in any event.
Okay, well, thank you.
Okay, thank you
so
very much.
And thank you all for coming.